Good evening. I welcome all for August month clinical meeting of Siddheshwar Urological Society. Our today's guest speaker is Dr. A. Selvam. He is a clinical embryologist and molecular genetics. He had completed MSc biotechnology from Algappa University, Tamil Nadu, and he worked for CSR, Government of India, and Indira Gandhi Center of Atomic Research, Department of Atomic Energy, Government of India. He had done PhD from Dong-A University, South Korea. And after that, he had done postdoctoral fellowship from Pusan National University, South Korea. He had 12 international publications and more than 40 international conference proceedings. Now he is working as a senior embryologist at Apollo Fertility, Solapur. I welcome Selvam sir. And I request Raghuji sir to give bouquet to sir. I also thank Indoco Remedies for sponsoring this CME. I request their manager to come and request Deshpande sir to give bouquet to them. I request A. Selvam sir to present there.
I should watch yes, here. Yes. Okay. It's online already. Start. Good evening, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So, thank you for a nice introduction, Dr. Fulari sir. So today, I must thank Dr. Deshpande sir also. To inviting me for this good occasion of Urologists Association meeting. I'm really happy to give a talk on importance of semen analysis in infertility treatment. So most of the people, they think semen analysis is just a small test. And they go for small labs and they just go for 200 rupees they pay and then they get tested for semen analysis. But nowadays, semen analysis is a very big thing which gives you a lot of information before a patient goes to fertility treatment. So nowadays, most of the fertility specialists and embryologists and even reproductive researchers, they are focusing on semen parameters rather than egg parameters or something. Most of the people are working on semen parameters because semen is abundantly available and easy to experiment on because eggs are very rare and you have minimal chance to experiment on. So this is the situation all over the world right now. So before going into actual talk, I would like to give a small introduction about our fertility center. So our fertility center is located in the campus of Sidgupkar Hospital in Samarth Chowk. So we are doing all these procedures at our center. from starting from semen analysis to cryopreservation. So we have like a DNA fragmentation index test, IUI. Excuse me. IVF, ICSI, laser-assisted hatching, PGTA, PGTM, and cryopreservation of gametes and embryos. So even recently, our Dr. Deshpande sir sent his patient, one of his patient, for onco-freezing. So which is a very important thing for oncologists and patients who are undergoing cancer treatment like chemotherapy or even radiotherapy. They need to protect their gametes. If they are not having children, they must go for preserving their gametes, whether it is a female or a male. In case of female, they will we need to stimulate their ovaries to produce more eggs, and those eggs will be oocytes will be frozen. So in case of a male, we will ask the patient to ejaculate and give 2-3 samples. Minimum 3 samples is required. We will cryopreserve their samples for long-term storage. Then even though they don't get the don't have a semen in later stage, they still have a frozen semen for their treatment. That is the idea behind it. And as you know, this is semen analysis. These are this just in elaborately I gave slides for better understanding. And this is a DNA fragmentation test we are doing. So during discussion, we can discuss about these things. Whoever interested, then we can go for that. This is an IUI we are doing, an IVF stimulation and proper IUI, IVF, and ICSI we are doing, and laser assisted hatching we are doing, and PGTA and PGTM we are that facility we have, and cryopreservation of gametes and embryos we are doing. And facilities, we have a specific dedicated lab for andrology and IUI and ART OT, like IVF OT we have, separate OT for the IVF pickup and embryo transfer. And we have a set of our IVF lab, and we are maintaining quality at a very high level because the detection limit of this machine is 1 ppm VOC. So that is lowest detection limit of this machine is 1 ppm. That much we are maintaining. VOC is 1 ppm. At that level, we are maintaining our laboratory. And this is general OT. We don't mix general surgical procedures in our main IVF OT. So we are separating it out from the IVF OT. Then here comes our actual talk here. So semen analysis, what are all the indications for semen analysis? So why we need to do semen analysis? So first of all, most of in our fertility setup, we are going to assess their fertility, their fertile capacity, their reproductive capacity we are going to check. But in previous days, people were thinking, whenever the couple don't have their own baby, so they try to blame on women only. But now it is totally changed. Most of the cases, men are responsible. Men are responsible for the problem because their semen parameter is not up to the mark. Even women is able to produce oocytes, the women, the spermatozoa don't have their proper capacity to reach those oocytes. So they're not able to fertilize the oocyte. So that's why they don't have the baby. And that is one major things we are doing. And then forensic purpose also, sometimes it is done. And to test vasectomy, effectiveness of vasectomy, because a man has undergone a vasectomy treatment, but he is not sure whether that vasectomy was proper. So he has to confirm by ejaculating and testing those ejaculatory material. They have to confirm whether it is absence of spermatozoa. Otherwise, there is no use of a vasectomy. So that is that purpose also. It is done. Semen analysis is done, and especially a person like me, when we are going for IVF, when we are doing ICSI or IVF, we need to see their samples. Even though many people they come to us and they will tell many patients, many male patients, they used to tell me, like, we have done so many times semen analysis. Why I have to go again? Line, we used to do for 200, 300 rupees. You are charging 1,000. How we can afford like that, they used to say. But if I am not knowing their actual sperm parameter, how I will be doing? Otherwise, I will be surprised to see their parameters on the day of actual treatment. So I need to pick single sperm, single best sperm to inject a single oocyte. So for that, I need to have a very clear understanding about their sperm parameter. So I always tell them, it is nothing. These 1,000 rupees is nothing in your whole treatment. This is going to be your first step in your treatment. So like that, I convince them, and not for the convince part, but it is the actual importance is lies in there. Even though they get more than 10 oocytes, if their morphology is very poor. So most of the time, even yesterday I had a case, their morphology is zero. They don't have even a 1% of morphology. I need to search for the better sperm. The out of those sperms, I need to go for maximum best possible sperm. Like that, the situation will be. In that case, we need to know their semen parameter perfectly. So for that, suitability for artificial insemination, whether it is IUI or IVF or ICSI, we have some parameters. This much quality the sperm should have to undergo this treatment. And this much parameter, this much criteria it should meet to undergo this treatment. Like that, we have some requirements. Those samples should meet those criteria. Otherwise, it is no use of going for that particular treatment. Like if we want to go for IVF, they have only 3 million sperms. There is no point. We can try. Actually, ICMR says we have to try a few times, but actually we know it's not going to work that much. Very rarely it works. That much poor quality sperm works for IUI means very, very rare chance. So for that, we must have to do semen analysis before starting their treatment, any kind of treatment. So that much important the semen analysis data is. It's not moving. So first, when a patient is ready to do semen analysis, their identification is very important, because in the same day, today we conducted a semen analysis camp. It's like for local Solapur people. They come like 10, 20 people, they come in the same day. So if they're in 1 minute, 5 minutes gap, 5 minutes interval, many patients will come. And we keep their containers in the incubators till we process it. So in that time, if we just miss their sample, the data will be confused. So we need to have very, and especially in this, when we are going for ICSI or something, if we miss the identification, is total collapse of this treatment, because they will be surprised to know that we are carrying other couple's baby. It happened even in recent days in California. It happened. One Asian couple were carrying Caucasian child. When they delivered it, they came to know it is Caucasian child. Automatically, it is known easily understandable. So it was a big chaos was there in California. That center was completely closed after that incident. So we have to be very specific, very clear in identification of samples, in especially in fertility treatment. And even many hospitals, they run a batch, like 20 people. Even in my previous places, I used to go to 2-3 freelancing things. In the same day, we do 5, 10, even 15 patients in a day. So you, in a tired atmosphere, you are handling 15 different eggs, 15 different spermatozoa. So you have to be very clear in everything, even pipette, tips, container, cement container, oocyte container, ICSI dish, culture dish, everything need to be properly labeled. Even if I'm just by mistake, I dipped one pipette in this container and touched the other container, done. Because just one pin drop of that amount is enough to contaminate other sample. That in that drop, you will have thousands of sperms. So if you are end up with picking those one of the thousand sample, the spermatozoa, that baby is going to be different person's baby. So this much serious things are there in identification. And then abstinence. We have to ask their abstinence. See, some people, they come for a treatment. After 1 month, they never had intercourse. His semen parameter will be totally different. And they just one person had intercourse yesterday, and he's giving sample. His parameter is going to be entirely different. But we cannot compare the manual, the setup, the criteria. We cannot compare when we are having different abstinence period. So for that, WHO has uniform abstinence period, which is 2 to 7 days. This range we can have, but not more than that. So abstinence, we have to ask. Otherwise, if they are having more abstinence or less abstinence, we have to ask them to come again with the proper abstinence. Means absence of sexual intercourse. Okay, time. What time they are giving? The sample, the time given, at time at which we received the sample. Because within 1 hour, we have to process the sample because we are going to see their liveliness, their activeness, their vitality, all the things. So when you are testing one sample within 30 minutes, another sample in 2 hours, it's not going to be same. So timing is important. Time you receive the sample and the time you process the sample. That is important. And that sample should be complete. Sometimes what they do, it is just masturbation. By masturbation only we are collecting the sample. That time what they will do, they try to open the container that time only, because they have to collect in the container, wide mouth container, but they keep closed till they are ready to ejaculate. So that time, what will happen? Some will spill. Especially we used to tell the patients, the first drop is very, very important because that is rich in spermatozoa. If you miss the first drop, you please notice us. Like that we used to strictly tell them, and make the container ready before you ejaculate, before you start ejaculating. So like that we used to tell, that is very important, completeness of the sample. And it is preferable they have to collect the sample in the near the lab. That is very important because it is easy to give instruction to them. It is easy to see, and it is better to confirm. Some couple we encountered, to hide his inability, or like that they have familial issues because of this. So what he used to do, he would tell his friend to give some sample and he deposit in our lab. So they used to say, in this atmosphere, I cannot collect the sample. I want to collect it in home. Like that he will tell, later he will come bring and give like this. So we ask consent for that also, because in case of semen analysis, it's fine. We will tell different count, different things. He will be happy and he will peacefully, he will live in his family. But later when he comes for the treatment, if he does the same thing, it's we are going to be in trouble. Because later the same person or same couple, they will blame. Like, you people mixed. It's not our fault. You people only mixed. Like that, they will turn the story. So it is very important to make sure we will write everywhere, even in the referral forms, even in the consent, everywhere we will write home collection like that. Because later it will, after 10 years, they will come. When the couple had a problem, when they will come to us, like, you people only mixed, like that they will tell. So that for that, we will always write in the container, in the report, everywhere we write home collection like that, in case if they are opting for home collection. That is, this much important things are there in this. And then, what are all the components in the sperm? So in the ejaculator semen, it is usually viscous and mixture of seminal plasma, testicular and epididymal secretions, and polygonal epithelial cells, and leukocytes, and live and dead spermatozoa. All the things will be there. So we are looking for, mostly we are looking for spermatozoa, but still other things gives us more meaning, more information. What is going on in his reproductive tract? These things will give a lot of information about that story. Like, what is going on in his reproductive tract, which creates this situation for him, like infection or blockage, many things. And then majorly we separate two different analyses. Like, one is macroscopic analysis and microscopic analysis. In macroscopic thing, we look for volume, how much volume he is able to produce, and what is the viscosity of the sample, and how much time it takes to liquefy. Like, when he ejaculate, it will be like a thick material, but after 20 minutes, it will become liquid. That process is called a liquefaction. That process, the time taken for this will give you a lot of information. What are all the secretions there in that sample? It depends on that, the liquefaction time will vary. So that gives a lot of information about that. And then chemical parameter, pH. We check pH. If we will go in detail later, pH, what is the meaning of pH, whether it is high means what, low means what, we will see in the next slides. And microscopic, when in the microscope, we put a drop of semen, that is, even we have a specific volume, specific cover slip we have to use to confirm the perfect count. Okay. So for that, and motility, morphology, viability, all these things we will do microscopically. And more importantly, this also biological sample need to be handled very carefully. For example, HIV, hepatitis, and many more things may spread through, as we know, spread through semen sample. So we have to handle it very carefully. Even last week, we had a couple, IUI couple, they had HBS. So after all the procedure is done, in the evening, we are spreading papers on the floor like that. Everything like wind up completely and clean it properly after that. That much we have to care. Otherwise, it will spoil other person's sample also. Like, if we are doing that person's as a first IUI in the morning, then we are having another IUIs, another cases, then it's going to spoil all the samples. So we will keep that as separate at the end of the day. So this is what we have to do when we are dealing with semen samples. And in microscopic analysis, as I said, volume is very important. So usually the semen will be thick, viscous when ejaculated. That time it will be thick and viscous. Later, it may take up to 60 minutes, but usually most of the samples will get liquefied in 10 minutes, maximum 20 minutes. But if it is it takes more time, means there is small abnormalities there in that sample. That's the meaning. But still it is allowed up to 1 hour. If it is exceeding 1 hour, it should be considered as a some abnormal secretions are there like that, we have to consider. And failure to liquefy, that means the prostate secretion is poor. Some inadequate prostate secretion is there. Maybe some problem with prostate gland. And viscosity, when we drop after liquefaction, we drop from height, the string will form. It should not exceed 2 centimeters. Usually it should drop like water. After liquefaction, it should drop like a water, but maximum 2 centimeters it can make a string. If it is making long string, yesterday I had one sample like that. Even I'm not able to put a drop on the slide to analyze. Just that much viscosity sample will come. That means it indirectly tells us how this spermatozoa will escape from that sample, that viscosity, how it will escape. When he deposits in the female reproductive tract, it has to escape from the seminal plasma and go to uterus and go to fallopian tube and meet the oocyte in ampulla region and then make it fertilize. This much things they have to go, but still it is trapped in the seminal plasma itself because of viscosity. So that might be the reason why they are not having baby. Okay, viscosity is also very important in this. And after liquefaction, we will measure the volume. So minimum it should be 1.5 according to WHO criteria, but it may maximum up to 5 ml also I have seen. Even some people had 7 ml. But the volume doesn't matter. How much content in it, how much quality in it, that matters. Because after all, we need only one good sperm to make one egg fertilize. Even though you are depositing 200 million sperm in the female reproductive tract, all the 200 million, like in the movie, these 3 Idiots, you might have seen in the first part, they still like millions of sperms are going, only one competitive wins and makes the embryo like that. So only one is going to make it, but that one should be perfect. At least that one should be there in the sample. That is the important thing. So volume doesn't matter, but the quality of the spermatozoa in it is important. And pH, we have to measure the pH also. pH gives us a lot of information about the semen quality. pH mean it should be 7.2 to 7.8. Maximum will be 7.5, around 7.5. But if it is greater than 7.5, it tells you there is an infection. There might be an infection in the reproductive tract of this man. And then if it is less than 7, there is a high chance of dysgenesis. So absence of failure to develop, vas deferens, seminal vesicles, or epididymis. These things possible. So pH looks is a very simple thing. Many small labs, they don't do pH because they are not aware of the importance of pH. Because just a litmus paper. After liquefaction, one drop of sample is needed to be dropped in the litmus paper. It will give you this much big information it gives. So this pH is very, very important to be checked for the during semen analysis. And then microscopic examination is for finding the sperm concentration, motility, and agglutination. And round cells such as spermatogonic cells and leukocytes. And also it is used for to find out motility, how fast, how best they are moving. So this is the chamber we used to according to WHO, we have to use this chamber for checking the motility count. These two things we have to use this only. This is how it looks like. So there will be grids. So at least 10 grids we have to score and in one line, and another vertical things also we have to do. And when it is better, when you are having a doubt, it's better to go as much grids as possible, and we have to divide. How many grids you are going, you have to divide. That is the thing we have to do with this count. So it's it may look simple when we are saying counting. Maybe it's easy to count how many people are here, but not as easy as this. counting the sperm, which is rapidly moving here and there. You can't see in the grid. It's going. It's not going to be there for even for a fraction of a second. It goes here and there. So that much you must that person need to be trained to quickly go through, quickly glance through these much grids. Okay, and then viability. Sometimes you may have a lot of sperms, but all are no one is moving. In that case, we have to check for the whether we have a lot of sperms, but they are not moving, whether at least they are live. Because if they are live, we can use for ICSI. If it is not happening with normal fertilization, natural pregnancy, we can go for ICSI in that case. Even last 2 weeks back, I had such situation. For that, we used one chemical to activate motility. Activate in the sense they don't run like a 100 meter race, at least they will wag their tail. So we come to know they are still living, they are live. So at least if we know they are moving, it is live, then I pick that sperm and inject into the oocyte. In that case only we will expect the fertilization. Otherwise, we will blindly we take dead sperm, it's not going to fertilize the oocyte. So that is what, for that we use eosin and nicrosin. In that pink color you see, that will that is they are dead, and white looking clear, they are live, because they don't allow the dye to go in. This principle is called dye exclusion principle, because the intact plasma membrane will not allow that stain go in to get into the cell. That's why it looks clear. And then agglutination. Agglutination is sticking each other. Like when they have a lot of sperms in it, but they are sticking each other, then how they will move? So that is also one of the problem with that. It may happen head to head sticking, tail to tail, or head to tail. This also another immunological factors. Like this antibody in this may match with antigen in that. That there is no clear research or clear things yet, but it's like almost hypothetical thing. So immunological things. And one more test is possible, available, MARC test, which is not routinely done in all the fertility centers. Okay, but this is also rare, because when you are having a lot of spermatozoa, few here and there, some agglutination is there, means it's not going to affect a lot. And then morphology. Morphology means shape of the sperm. You have a lot of sperm. You have a very highly moving sperm, but still their shape is not proper. Like they need to have an acrosome in the head. They need to have a proper nucleus in the head. They need to have a proper mitochondria in it. They need to have a proper tail. That means some genetic defect is there. That's why they are not proper. So these are all the things. For morphology is very, very big thing. And to test morphology, the person need to at least 6 months training for morphology itself, because so many parameters are there. Vacuoles you have to see. You have to see the ratio of acrosome and nucleus, so many things. And in one sample, you don't find all the parameters. That is another big thing. In one sample, you don't find. If this person may have globosuspermia, in my experience, I have seen only 2% so far, means without acrosome. So that much rarity is there. So you need to allow the person to feel so as many samples as possible to get trained. So they look like this, hematoxylin eosin staining. But later, bigger picture, we will get a better, this morphology is done by papanicolaou staining. Okay, this is normal spermatozoa, looks like this. So you can see acrosome here and nucleus is here, midpiece. This here only mitochondria will be there. This mitochondria gives the energy for the movement. And tail flagellum, with this tail only they move. And there are so many different abnormalities are there. So in this here, same thing comes here. The same person may not have all these abnormalities. So yesterday I saw one sample that spermatozoa is moving backside, reverse. So most, very rarely it happens. They have to move forward. but they are moving this way. We can't justify how it happens. Most many things are moving backside. So it's quite funny sometimes. So these kind of morphologies, you can see various type of morphologies, and all the morphology you don't find in the same sample. That is another hurdle in this. And okay, we tested the semen sample and somehow some person has azoospermia. That case is very tough to decide before giving counseling or before giving the report. We have to double check many things. We have to think again, and then we have to go for azoospermia. First, we have to check cryptozoospermia. Cryptozoospermia means we have 3 ml of sample. We are putting one drop of sample on the slide, and we are looking in one location. In one drop of the sample, you will have 1,200 fields. And at the time, you can see only one field. And I'm seeing in one field, and I'm concluding, okay, fine, this patient has no sperm. Azoospermia, if I write it, it's going to be a big disaster for his lifetime. So I have to, at the same time, I cannot go for 1,200 field for every patient who walks into our center. So for that, what we have to do? Field we have to see, and then we have to concentrate the sperm, centrifuge it, and collect it in the bottom as a pellet, and then dissolve in less volume of the media or the same seminal plasma, and then try for the testing. Still, if it is not there, then we have to give cryptozoospermia ruled out. That means cryptozoospermia is not there. We have to go to next thing. Retrograde ejaculation. We have to ask the patient whether you had a feeling sometimes because of instead of coming to urethral opening, it go back to bladder. By mistake, it goes like that. Some people have that kind of things. That is called retrograde ejaculation. In that case, after ejaculation, their urine need to be checked. So that big process, big protocol is there. We are running out of time. So, and then obstructive, then we have to go for whether it is obstructive or non-obstructive. Obstructive means we have to go for a fructose test. If fructose test is negative, then it may be obstructive. If it is positive, then we have to consider as a non-obstructive. And then aspermia, sometimes they do, but no sperm comes out. No fluid also comes out. That is aspermia. So azoospermia is different, aspermia is different. And then due to some genetic defect also, they are not able to make any sperm. Like some azoospermia factor gene is there. In Y chromosome, we have some part which is responsible for producing this sperm. So that is missing. So many people, they go for Y chromosome deletion test also, genetic test. And major thing, this is very popular thing, CBAVD, congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens. That is also very general situation in many patients. And these are all the things done by following WHO manuals. It's not like everybody can have their own protocol or can have their own way of doing it. It's not so. It should be uniform all over the world. So WHO is giving a proper protocol by testing many people. Many millions of people around the world, they are testing and they are making database. From that, they are giving the reference values. Okay. So this was 2010, fifth edition. So recently, now 2 months back, sixth edition has come. That is, but there is no much difference between fifth edition, sixth edition. Very slight difference, because that means even fifth edition itself, most of the things were set properly. So we are happy to know that actually. Very few, very 1-2% changes are there in the sixth edition, which is recently launched by WHO. And what are all the parameters actually given in fifth edition? These are all the things. Semen volume should be minimum 1.5 ml. Count total sperm should be 39 million. Sperm concentration, that is in 1 ml, it should be 15 million. Total mortality should be 40%. Progressive should be 32. Vitality should be 58. Now it is reduced to 54 in the 6th edition. 54 vital sperms, vital live sperms. Okay, and then sperm morphology, 4%. Just you have 100 sperms, you scored 100 sperms, only 4 sperms are good means they are able to consume naturally. Naturally, they can get consume naturally if they are having 4%. So what the situation, whoever comes to us, they are having 1%, 0%. That is why they are not able to conceive. But I see many reports done by some small pathology laboratory. They give 60% normal morphology. It is really funny, you know. It's not at all possible. That means they must able to have a baby. There's no doubt about it. Okay. There are some other criteria also, some old criteria they may be following, which is not going to help us. We are following Kruger's strict morphology criteria. That is what we are following. Okay. And then pH, as we know, already we discussed. So it must be more than 7.5, 7.2 or more. And then MAR test, these are all very rare tests. Seminal fructose, this is very important. It should be more than 30 micromole. It's micromole. It's, the unit is not given, it's micromole. That should be that much. And then other things are seminal zinc and all, not many people are doing. Okay, that's all. And then terminology, aspermia means totally no liquid is coming. Zoo, wherever zoo is, zoo suffix is there, that means it tells spermatozoa, not the whole volume, whole liquid. Here, aspermia means whole liquid. Talk about whole liquid. So here, teratozoospermia, asteno means movement. It is motility. Whether lack of motility means asthenozoospermia. Lack of count means oligozoospermia. Lack of morphology, less morphology means terato. So if it is combination, asthenoterato means low motility, low morphology. Oligoterato, oligoasthenoterato, all the three are poor. Like count also less, motility also less than normal reference, and morphology also less. That means OAT, oligoasthenoteratosuspermia, like that we tell. There are so many, this is only few of them are listed here. So many things are there. So we are most, I took a lot of time. So we go for a Q&A session. If at all you have some questions, please ask. Let's have a discussion. Thank you for that. Hope you enjoyed. Yeah, please.
You talked about the characterization of sperms. What is the cost and how long?
It depends, but in cryopreservation, usually if they are having enough count and motility, you can store for a long period, like even 5 years, 10 years is possible. Even incident in UK, after 50 years, one embryo was transferred, frozen embryo transfer, then they got the baby. After 50 years, see how much fantastic technology we have in this world. Because it is stored at minus 196 degrees Celsius. It's not freezer. It's freezer also we are storing for a long time, like our ice creams and all we are putting in. But this is minus 196, not about freezer, which is minus 18. This is minus 196 we are talking about. Okay, even people are thinking about preserving organisms, some endangered organisms, the whole organisms they are planning, because endangered birds, endangered animals, they are going to extinct, right? So they are trying to do cryopreservation of those animals. So cost wise, it varies, package varies, which I'm not involved in. Please consult with our center head. Okay, you can please visit, or I will give the number of them. You can talk to them.
How to identify
Yeah, very good. There are so many tests for testing whether they are live or dead. This is easy test, which I talked about. Host test, we call it as host test, hypoosmotic swelling. What will happen? Live sperms, I told plasma membrane in eosin, acrosin, dye exclusion principle, this host test is just opposite. You know, osmosis, you know, osmosis you might have studied in high school. We in the permeable membrane, between permeable between two different concentration solutes, we are keeping a permeable membrane. Then this highly concentrated solution will get diluted by this less concentrated solution till both the levels are equal concentration. That is for understanding principle. But here what happens, we use some chemical, some solution to make swell higher concentration than sperm tail concentration, whatever cytoplasmic concentration. So what will happen? Less means this ooze out, ooze in actually, ooze into the sperm, then this swell. Like if you use some soaps and all, your cells will be, some concentrated soaps, your cells damaged. You might have noticed some washing soap and all, detergents. The same mechanism, like that water, the chemical releases some water to balance the concentration. In that process, that sperm swells. So hypoosmotic, hypo means less. We are giving less concentrated solution to make the sperm swell. Hypoosmotic swell test. Another test also there, which we give shot with the laser. So they are dead. We assume they are alive. So we are suspecting one sperm and we are hitting with the laser shot. Then they will wag the tail. That way also we come to know they are live or dead. But easy test this. So for semen analysis, we don't need to waste that chemical, which is costly. But we go for that test when we are doing ICSI, because this stain will kill this. This will make this sperm useless for ICSI, for the treatment. But for analysis is fine. And we are going to throw the sample. That's fine. But in the case of treatment, we have to go for host test. That depends on the purpose. Okay, sir. Nice. Very happy to share that. Because semen analysis, it won't come. It will come in IVF treatment. But still, that is the test. Because if at all it deals with money, na, the semen analysis, we are charging them. If we are doing host test for semen analysis itself, then we have to charge more. Then the patient will fed up with charge. So we have to go for eosin acrosin test. Any other? Did I say in the first slide? We can go to that slide. It is easy. How to go there? It is automatic. You are handling?
Yes.
Okay, fine. So, please go one by one. Please stop there. So for this also, same as you asked about host test, this term, DNA fragmentation also has so many variety of tests to do that. But the simplest method is sperm chromatin dispersion test. This is the simplest test. What they will do, when there are so many steps are there, we lyse the spermatozoa and then we stain it and later we see it. And here if you see, there are so many sizes, different sizes. All are sperms only. All are single person's sperms only. Okay, here if you see biggest thing. Okay, this is also sperm. Here you see smallest sperm, smallest thing. This is also sperm. So how it would happen? Actually, the sperm is actual size is this one only. Actually, this is the right size. And this is degraded thing. Degraded. We the bigger the size, normal spermatozoa. Because here we are not going to see the live spermatozoa. We are here to see the content, the nucleus, the DNA, how much intact it is. If the DNA is intact, when we are opening the cell, when we are breaking the cell, this DNA will be spread out around the sperm head. But if they are broken, they disperse in the solution. So they look smaller. But if they are intact, they look bigger. Clear? So the bigger the size is normal. So we have to count at least 500 sperms. And then if it is less than 20% abnormal DNA fragmentation is there, it's better. Like more than 90% good means best. Because when we are going for semen ICSI, we don't see the DNA. We just see outer appearance. Outer appearance, we cannot judge the book by its cover. No? So we will see the outer surface only. We don't see here. So to minimize the failure chance, we go for this DNA fragmentation test. Clear?
How often do you need assistance of a urologist? You make it a point to see that every patient has to be seen by him, or only when you're necessary, especially for
him? Yeah, mostly andrologists. I'm not clear about clear difference between urologist and andrologist. Both are same. Same only, na? Same, then fine. So whenever he comes to man, comes to semen analysis, if he's any kind of abnormality is there, especially azoospermia is there, he must visit. Azoospermia, because in the slide itself I told azoospermia is not having one factor, multiple factors. We just suggest my role is finished. I just test the sample and I will tell fructose test need to be done, because to rule out obstructive, non-obstructive. Even it is obstructive, I'm not going to do with anything with that. Even it is non-obstructive, I'm not going to do anything with that. If at all they are ready, they are able to give the sample, I can handle. Otherwise, we suggest donor. But urologist, andrologist, you are only going to treat them to cure that thing. For example, because of varicocele, he may have a problem. Because of obstruction, small obstruction may be there, or some tumor may be there in the this gland, prostate gland. Maybe in problem. So those things, definitely he has to come to you people. No doubt about that. And nowadays, more percentage of male factor infertility is increasing because of lifestyle, because of their eating habits, because of their professions. So they must go for andrologist opinion. That's why we are having SAR most of the time. So we can't, our fertility specialist, she's specialized in female part only. So we need SARS assistance there. Same way, all the andrologists need to be part of fertility treatment. There is no doubt about it.
Primarily, these patients come from
that. Yeah, yeah. Right? Because they have no idea, actually. The couple have no idea, actually. They think, because in he is the responsible for this. You only make a baby. What I will do? Like that, they used to escape. But nowadays, it is proved. Like their sperm parameter is important. They have some problem. Even though they are able to intercourse, doesn't mean that they are able to make the egg fertilize. That is different. This is different. That some people, they confused with that. Even when we ask for the sample, sir, why I have to do a semen analysis? Unnecessarily, you are wasting our money. I'm completely all right in sexual life. Like that they used to say. They don't know this difference. Because if at all, they are not knowing these biological things. So they think both are same. this is completely different.
I have one practical question.
Yeah, please, sir. If I know, I will.
When we tell the patients to collect the sample of semen,
yeah,
we will not give them a comfortable space. Normally, we will tell them, do the semen analysis. Lab people will give her one bottle and they will tell them to collect in the toilet. And in the toilet, in the hospitals, many people will be waiting. They will knock the door.
It disturbs.
They will come. And as you told, as for me, because most of the times they will give only urethral secretions. They will not give the semen sample. Then, so it's most important. I want to ask you, in the Apollo Fertility Center, what provision you have made to collect the sample?
Okay, good question. I'm sorry. I had that slide. I deleted in this presentation because to reduce the number of slides. So I quickly go through, I wanted to go through quickly because I cannot talk about Apollo Fertility for a long time rather than talking about semen analysis. So I skipped those slides. Actually, we have two separate dedicated rooms for them with the sofa, with the bed, with the TV.
Yeah,
okay. That much facility we give, AC. With AC, with remote there itself, we don't disturb them. Two different rooms are there. And very interesting situation happened yesterday. Yesterday, we had a pickup, one patient only. His sperm was poor. 3 days back, his sperm was poor. So we asked him to give for freezing. Because in case if his sperm is not proper, not good, good enough to do ICSI today, we end up with wasting these oocytes. So we preserve backup as a backup sample, but we always prefer fresh sample only for the actual ICSI. So I asked him to give the freezing sample. That was very poor. Yesterday, he came to a hospital. He came on time. He was not able to produce the sample. No, this actually... It become very good situation. Then the OT technician was helping him, instructing him to collect. And he was coming to me, sir, he's not able to collect, what we can do? Then I called him, do you have any videos in your phone like that? I asked, you go for it.
Yeah.
You know, the surprise is his sample was very, very good. It looks funny, but ultimately what we need good sperms that with arousal, so like when we are seeing getting stimuli, we are getting stimuli and brain, we are activating the brain and then whole system is working. Just like that for sake of testing or sake of sampling you are doing, you end up with this useless sample. So it gives me a lot of pleasure yesterday, actually, a lot of happiness, because I was worried about that. His sperm was very poor. Even if I take from frozen sample, it's not going to help me, because whatever good sample you freeze, you will lose at least 10 to 20% when you are freezing, thawing. So you will lose. So he had only 3 million. What I can expect from the thawing sample. So I was very much worried, but the fresh sample he was given after a struggle, it was very good. That one incident helped him. So I realized, previously we studied, we heard about it, but I really experienced yesterday, he was giving very good sample. So very good, sir. Thank you for bringing this story. It just yesterday happened.
Are you accepting
seven
samples from outside of
examination?
Suppose if I want
home collection. Yeah. I will talk to our center head. He will arrange. You can refer. You can refer, sir.
IVF center, we send the seven.
Yeah, quality is very important, sir. That's what I was telling.
See,
yes, sir.
You are accepting those.
Yeah, we are expecting. We are accepting. We are even for some people who are not having a lab, but they are interested to IUI, we we process their sample and we charge.
Are you asking this for
examination? Yeah.
In-house, there are a lot of
labs. Yes, sir, I understand. I'm understanding it. We charge it, but the normal charge will apply for the patient. We are doing.
But you are entertaining.
Yeah, we are entertaining. I will talk to, even if they are not doing so far, I will talk to them and I will do. No issue about it. If at all, see, in that process, we also get benefited, because if at all they are coming for treatment, they may come again for our, so they will definitely accept that. Any other?
You said regarding home office.
Yes, sir. Yeah, 1 hour. Within 1 hour, you have to bring the sample here.
If it doesn't happen, then what you
do? Well, it is that
nearby.
They have to arrange for it. Otherwise, result may not be perfect. What we can do? That, like, instead of having 100% perfect result, we may end up with 80% perfect result. That we have to tolerate. We have to understand that. That's all.
We can start semi-ambulance.
Okay, sir. That also we can do. Yeah, sure, sir.
Green corridor.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir. You brought many of my information outside. Thank you, sir. I recalled many things actually because of this.
Thank you, Dr. Selvam.
You are available after all the days.
Yes, sir. I'm working as an in-house only.
Whenever you people are interested, come there or visit me. Please tell me. I will assist you. Then I not like other examination.
Yeah, definitely. Even if you are interested to, sir was spending like 1 hour last week. He was watching all the protocols, all the things.
Majority of them you have seen them.
Yeah. Oh, you have seen.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So if at all you are interested also, I'm happy to explain.
I thank Dr. Selvam for a wonderful presentation. I would like to present 2 cases if time permits. This is a 2.5 month old male child presented to us after a full term normal delivery. He was a known case of antenatal hydronephrosis. Sibling was normal. He presented after 2.5 months with occasional fever. Total count was raised. Creatinine was 1.1. Urine was showing 150 to 200 per cells. Ultrasound was showing right moderate hydronephrosis and entire hydroureter, and left side gross hydronephrosis with thin cortex. We have done his DMSA, DTPA, and reflux study, radionucleotide reflux study. That was showing left side poor function around 11%, and right side was obstructed with no scar. I think this is a reflux study. So that was showing left sided reflux with right-sided obstructive system. So how to proceed with this patient?
Yeah, right, sir.
On DT, on DTP scan, EC scan.
Yeah, yeah. Have you done any contrast studies?
Contrast study we have not done because he had a fever and pus cells are plenty of there. So we have not done for
plain CT.
Plain CT was done. That was also showing same picture like ultrasound. Means right side. No, just. But right side cortex was good and left side thin cortex was there. And entire head regulator.
Both side.
Both side.
MCU was not done.
MCU was not done because of fever and pus cells.
You did the reflux study on?
Radionucleotide scan. That was showing reflux only on left side.
Not on right side.
Not right side.
Why contrast CT was not on?
Creatinine was raised 1.1 slightly. For his age, it is much more.
So he has got a reflux in left side.
And non-reflux
in obstructive
right. I don't know what is exact.
What is the role of CT? Is what extra information?
Yeah, anatomical information you will get better with the CT. Better than sonography.
About the site of
obstruction.
All these nuclear studies will give you
a function. Site of obstruction means it is.
The anatomical information.
It cannot give level of
obstruction. Level of obstruction, but ultrasound was showing hydronephrosis and hydroureter.
So there is a lower
urinary. Yes.
Oh, might be an obstructed
megaurethral lens. Might be. So, that in reflux study, they asked to rule out P walls, posterior urethral walls. So, we went for cystoscopy. Walls were there, but posterior urethra was not much dilated. And the bladder full of pus, frank pus was there. Already in first flex are there, means like a muscle. Hi, this patient, same patient. What's that?
This picture again, did it correlate with the
obstruction?
Yes.
Basically, it was a view wall with the bilateral view wall.
Might be.
And because when you see the.
Because of their. Maybe because of gross reflux on left side. Means radionuclide scan didn't go on right side.
Radionuclide scan for diagnosing the thing is very
difficult.
You can only judge the function line. You can't view the anatomical diagnosis. What is the problem? So basically, as per your this thing, it was a view wall with the bilateral view wall.
No. What? No. Now, patient is admitted with us.
But subsequently, we wanted to have a diagnosis scope and see whether the problem is there. During the course of scoping, it was have a posterior wall was there. Classical was there. I think probably you
don't have. No, video was not there.
Then only question remains here because the left thing is totally final. And
frank pus is there. In 2-3 days, only pus is draining through the catheter.
Only was. If it is a PUV, bilateral difference can be expected. But why an action absolutely with the issue? That was the only point. Now the issue is there. Is urea is not settling still. He discharged came once again with the admission. So now, question was whether you should not.
Yes.
I feel is like you first do vesicostomy, and if it doesn't subside, then you do urethroscopy. That is the thing what we have been.
But like if it is a pilot procedure, the ureter is a direct atrocious. Vasectomy, it will not settle. Then again, you have to go for one more surgery like 30 minutes. And closure of ureter, vasectomy is again a bigger time.
Ureterostomy is also the same thing.
Vasectomy closure is the same thing.
Vasectomy closure is not a big problem.
Vasectomy closure is not
a problem.
Is
small.
Which system brings what?
Why bladder is small?
Whether it is a loop ureterostomy or vasectomy. Both has to be decided.
Yes.
But some diversion, it may be some,
yes.
What I feel.
Yes.
Because you are not searching. We have to look for different direction. What I feel. But I
think.
The message, what you want.
Like if you want some definitive treatment in immediate future, why not only nephrostomy?
Depending upon your experience.
No, no, but what is about right side? Right side? Right side is a better functioning kidney.
See, basically the problem is in the urethra. See,
means
that's the one more point I want to ask you. Because if you do left side, where you do right side,
it will take process. We are just
no, ureterostomy will not take care of the scene, sir. Sir, please, don't be so this thing. What I want to tell you, it's a P wall. First of all, it's a P wall. There is a reflex on the right side and the left side. Right side is a better functioning kidney.
There is no reflex on right side.
That's the thing what I want to tell you. Vasectomy will be a better option than a ureterostomy. Because as per my knowledge, we have done vasectomy more than ureterostomy.
Basic difference between pediatric surgeon and urologist is vasectomy. Go to the literature, if you go to glass, there is a contraction to do a second solution. There is a glass work classification. We have graded according to pressures, right to do ureterostomy.
Right side the kidney, what is the solution for that?
It takes care of case if you want to do to bilateral.
No, answer, we do bilateral ureterostomy, then bladder and
how will that discover that if you are doing a proximal ureterostomy, you are doing it like upper ureter and it is a reflux. So the pressure will definitely go to the past of this.
Already God has given that pop-up reflex. What it is there, it is going on the left side. That's
a difference.
There is no question. Then why you are explaining that? Why you want to explain that? You are going behind the pop-up reflex only.
No.
See, when you do a cutaneous ureterostomy, you are telling that the right kidney will be draining better.
The right
kidney
is not obstructed.
Ah.
It is obstructed because of hypertension. So
how will ureterostomy help the right kidney?
It will help to take care of the pressures. We are interested in pressure.
Well, how pressure of the bladder will be changed when
right side is really obstructed. नहीं है राइट साइड इज नॉट ऑब्स्ट्रक्टेड नहीं है हाइपर हाँ करेक्ट
मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम the patient is not in a that bad condition, even just putting a feeding tube will once you drain the bladder, in children it is very difficult to manage. That's the reason vasectomy is the option for that. Supravesical diversion, as per this thing, it is very rare.
We have to be optional types. Let us see what we get to it. I think so.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Oh,
proximal. What Akshay is saying that right side will also drain from the left ureter.
Because of reflux. But if the system is, but what you say is an obstructed system.
It is not really obstructed. It is not really obstructed. It is because of that hypertrophied bladder. If it is really obstructed, then right side should have more parenchymal problem than the left side.
स्कूपी
करून वॉल फॉलग्रेशन केलेलं आहे सर. ते दुसरं केस this only I have a sonography and IVP picture. This is around 55-year-old female patient presented with left colic. And ultrasound right side was normal, left side moderate hydronephrosis and enterohydroureter. This is the ultrasound report. So just around 50-55. Female patient. So pseudo ureter seal, what ultrasound is seen. That's why I'm written as
known, because only thing is because some of the ultrasound report they confuse with the thyroid
glands. Huh? Thyroid
glands. May be a stone, but which they will not pick up. Pseudo ureter seal is mentioned.
And that is also proximal to VUJ.
Sir,
first
of all, I'll tell you, I think in the present scenario, radiologists are so busy with the ultrasound.
Mm-hmm.
We can't rely on the ultrasound report.
Yes.
We have to have some proper anatomical study.
Hey, patient, आजच आलो.
नाही, मागच्या साईडला आलो होतो तुम्ही ना.
Subjective.
And this is the IVP picture. So is that thoda magnify karte hain?
Yeah, theek.
Plain India. Normal. IVP is done. मागच्या सॅटरडे तुम्ही नव्हते त्यावेळेस. नथिंग.
I mean, lower ureteric stone may be ready. If you do a CT, I do CT or perhaps plain CT or a
rate command. No, just new. I say, patient I asked for cystoscopy and left arm.
Sorry, plain CT.
Anyway, she was symptomatic, that's why I asked for stenting. Patient was not ready. Last Saturday's patient. So just unusual, huh? Only lower ureter is dilated, unusual IVP. No. Female patient. Yes, sir? No. Only lower ureter is much dilated. Upper ureter looks fine. Suspect box.
Age
50-55. Then it takes a lot of time. Your analysis.
Bladder looks okay.
Permission is not confirmed. Last Friday's patient, she might come. Duplex in here. I thank you all the delegates who are online also and physically present for attending the CME. Thank you very much. 6 months.
We give a big mass and we really showed the kind of touches and subsequently